Thank you, sis.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. Those were some photos taken by one of tonight's speakers, Marilena Deli, set to the song titled Hatred Drove Me From My Home. Good evening, everyone. My name is Isa, and I'm a bookseller at Politics and Prose Bookstore, and I'd like to welcome you all to PNP Live. Thanks for joining us in this virtual format in the midst of these extraordinary times, throughout all of which we strive to continue to bring you the authors you love and their books to the Politics and Prose community. At any point during the event, you can click on the link in the chat to purchase the panelists' books, which is Witch Hunting and Women by Silvia Federici and Silenced by Sound by Ian Brennan on the Politics and Prose website. Additionally, you can ask the panelists a question by clicking on Q&A, which can be found near the bottom of your screen. And while we'll try to get to everyone's questions, we apologize in advance if we don't have time to address yours. Finally, we want to thank you for being here with us today. We're so thankful for our family of loyal customers, keeping our business and our spirits afloat. It is now my pleasure to introduce tonight's speakers. First off, we have Silvia Federici. She is a feminist, activist, writer, and a teacher, as well as one of the co-founders of the 1972 Wages for Housework campaign. Her books include Witches, Witch Hunting and Women, Caliban and the Witch, and most recently, Beyond the Periphery of the Skin, which explores the question, what does the body mean today as a category of social and political action? She has written extensively on philosophy and feminist theory, women's history, education, and culture, and more recently, the worldwide struggle against capitalist globalization and for a feminist reconstruction of the commons. Next up, we have Marilena Umoza Deli. She is a photographer, author, and filmmaker whose work has been published around the world by the BBC, CNN, NPR, Al Jazeera, Vice, Liberation, Rolling Stone, Smithsonian, The New York Times, among others. Her work centers the artists from underrepresented countries like Rwanda, Malawi, South Sudan, Pakistan, Cambodia, and Romania. Deli is also a human rights activist who has written two books about racism in Italy based on her own experience growing up with an immigrant mother in one of Italy's most conservative regions. And last up, we have Ian Brennan. He is a Grammy-winning music producer and the author of four books. He has worked with the likes of John Waters, Merle Haggard, and Green Day, among others. His work has been featured on the front page of the New York Times and on an Emmy-winning 60-minute segment. His latest book, Silenced by Sound, delves into his personal story to address the inequity of distribution and the arts. Everyone, please join me in welcoming Silvia Federici, Marilena Umoza Deli, and Ian Brennan to Politics and Prose Live.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Ethan.
Hi,
Silvia.
Ciao, Silvia.
Ciao, ciao. I just wanted to say at the start a couple things, and after that, I'd really love to hear Marlena and Silvia talk about their experiences and as Italianas, especially that's important. Today, we're announcing officially the release of Witch Camp Ghana, a record that was recorded in northern rural Ghana with women accused of witchcraft, mostly elderly and often disabled women. And I just want to be very clear that with these projects that we do, we've done over 30 now, throughout the world with underrepresented populations and regions, the goal is not exotic. The goal is exactly the opposite, to de-exoticize and find the commonality in humanity, particularly for those that are exploited and often vulnerable. And this occurs, this objectification, so often with women more than others, so often with the elderly more than others, and so often with the poor. And we are, in our little way, these voices move me. And I hope that they help build empathy for others as well. And it's a very personal connection, having relatives, a mother-in-law who is a disabled, elderly, widowed, and having a sister who has Down syndrome, and seeing the persecution and the abuse that she went through just in this COVID lockdown, and the trauma that she suffered just in this past year, and knowing how important it is to not objectify others and not dehumanize others, because that is always the first step towards violence of all sorts. And it's very important, I think, to always note that the Nazis' first targets were the mentally ill and the disabled. So I'll be here if anybody has questions or to chime in, and at the end there'll be questions, but otherwise I'd love to hear from Marlena and Silvia, who knows so much and has brought so much brilliance and insight to all of us.
Well, thank you. Before talking to Silvia, I'll be asking Silvia a few questions. I just want to say that I'm very thrilled of being here with Ayan and with Silvia tonight. And I was just telling Silvia, gosh, I wish I had read Witches, Witch Hunting and Women when I was a child, because all women need to be educated with this book. And maybe I would have, made the different choices in life, and maybe I would have built my confidence earlier, you know. And so I've been working with Ayan for the past almost 13 years now. And we've been recording artists from underdeveloped countries, like Rwanda, my mother's country. And we decided to go to Ghana because we thought that, the problem of witch hunting in Ghana needed to be to have a bigger platform. And so we recorded over 100 women. They were mostly over elderly, and these women, for the first time, open their hearts, their experiences, their feelings through music, and they used things that they had in the immediate environment, like teapots, tin cans, tree limbs, corn husks. And they wrote songs like the one that we just listened to. There was track number 2, Hatred Drove Me From My Home. I mean, it says it all right there. Or there are songs like track 16, Abandoned, Forced Into a Life of Prostitutions, or track number 20, Left to Live Like an Animal. I personally have suffered from witch hunting. A family member of mine in Malawi have been accused of being a witch. And so she has been ostracized from her village. And so she suffered because of it. She suffered all of her life. And also, as Ian was saying, my mother is from Rwanda, and she's elderly, she's disabled. She did survive three genocides, but at the wrong place, at the wrong time, she could totally be a victim of this witch hunting. And the problem with witch hunting is that transform women, just like Silvia Federici says very well in her books, into monsters. They're dehumanized and they're accused of disgregating a community when instead they're trying to keep it together. And the fault is of these big Western corporations who are recolonizing Africa, manipulating younger people, chiefs of villages, who are trying to send all these elderly women, these single women with the local businesses away so that they can use and seize their land and sell it to these big corporations. It's a big problem. And so I just want to read a part of witches, witch hunting and women, and then I'm going to have Silvia talking about it. So witch hunting has taken on a life of its own so that the same mechanisms can be now applied to different societies whenever there are people in them that have to be ostracized and dehumanized. Witchcraft accusations, in fact, are the ultimate mechanism of alienation and estrangement as they turn the accused, still primarily women, into monstrous beings dedicated to the destruction of their communities, therefore making them underserving, undeserving of any compassion and solidarity. So I just wanted you, Silvia, expand on that for us. Thank you.
Yes. Oh, thank you. Thank you all for inviting me, and thank you, Jan, and thank you. I want to say, first of all, a few words about how I came to, you know, the research, the study of the issue of witch hunting. You know, I was involved in the women's movement. I continue to be, and for many, many years, I did research as part of reconstructing women history in Europe and in the world. I did research on the witch hunts in Europe. And one conclusion that I came to was that this had nothing to do with the Middle Ages, with superstition and so on, and a lot to do instead with the kind of transformation that were taking place with the transition to a capitalist economy. And the fact that people were being pushed off the land and also that a new discipline of labor were coming into place, they had particularly specific effects, you know, on the life of women, and that the witch hunts were in a way a whole preparation to a new kind of discipline that affected women in particular, and controlled by the state over their body, their sexuality, and so forth. Caliban and the Witch was published in 2004, but already, as I was the last few years that I was doing this work, I was already hearing about new witch hunts, and particularly in Africa, but also, you know, in a way expanding, and soon in India and then in Papua, and coming from the work that I've been done, immediately my hypothesis was that once again, this new witch hunt had to do with the big transformation that I knew were taking place, beginning with the African continent, you know, starting in the 80s, you know, with the expansion of capitalist relations, globalization, the imposition by the International Monetary Fund of the politics of structural adjustment. I mean, people maybe don't know what structural adjustment, but this was a whole packet of reforms that was imposed on practically all the former colonial regions, you know, and in the name of a debt crisis that was very artificially fabricated, you know, and these reforms were really a process of recolonization. That's really, in a way, what took place starting in the 80s and 90s. Recolonization means that, you know, where you have country, they have now their own flag and they have their own government. But fundamentally, in every economic matter, you know, they are dependent on the world decision of international capital and massive dispossession of people from land, you know, land privatization, massive dislocation, impoverishment. The states, the government were told to cut every investment into reproduction, basic services. So you have a process in a number of years that in fact begins to tear communities apart, because when the land is taken away from you, when the more traditional form of support are also not accessible. And so the internal tension begin to accumulate. And there is a whole new conception of what is valuable, what is not valuable, that creates a lot of tension in the community. So, and I'll go more in detail later, but this is where I place, you know, I place the witch hunt that are taking place now practically across the continent, as well as in India, in Papua New Guinea, is Timor, because now, and it's beginning in Latin America, Guatemala, Brazil, we're beginning to see cases of people actually killed, you know, in accused of witchcraft. So the figures are not easy to come by, no, but there is an agreement that the phenomenon has been continuously increasing, starting with the late 80s through the 90s. In some cases, the numbers are very high. I mean, I've read reports according to which, for example, in Tanzania, you know, in the last decade, you had more than 400 women killed. And the way normally a persecution occurs is not usually the state. Usually the persecution occurs in the form of either an individual killing, a person he accuses of being a witch, or you have a group of a gang, often of young people, or you have a mob, right? But this is where the kind of structure. And usually it comes at the end of accusation that this person has caused untold suffering, killing, damaging property, causing people to be impotent, et cetera, et cetera.
Silvia, sorry to interrupt you. Sure. Thank you for what you said. It's very important. And in Ghana in particular, the new business class describes the witch as a greedy woman, a woman who is envious of rich people, a woman who is completely irrational just for the fact of investing in the local business so that she can have the full control of money beginning to the end, instead of investing in these big international Western corporations who are recolonizing Africa. And it's incredible how these TV shows and radios in Ghana, as you describe very well, are telling people how to, explaining to people how to identify witches. And witch hunting is a major topic also in music, in films, and there are echoes of the Middle Age witch hunting. So witches are believed to be flying, to be able to fly at night. They practice cannibalism. As you were saying, they can sterilize people, they can bring death, they can cause damage to your crop. And I want to go back to your book and talk about the Ghanaian sociologist Mensa Adinkra, who reports, you know, in recent years, the infliction of violence against suspected or accused witches has emerged as a major form of human rights abuse in Africa. Many local and international media agencies have reported scores of people being threatened, intimidated, tortured, or murdered on suspicion of witchcraft. Studied mostly by anthropologists, witchcraft accusations and killings should concern all feminists, North and South. Now, Silvia, why isn't this happening? Why aren't they caring about this problem, which is woman's problem?
I think that one of the reasons, this is a question that I've raised myself many times and also with women, and particularly women in Africa. And I think one of the reasons has been that the fear, in Africa, the fear is that insisting or giving too much attention to the question of witch hunting is reinforcing a very racist and colonialist conception of the African as backward, as superstitious, and that these new witch hunts are seen as, you know, part of a long history of African superstition, right? That this is the image that will be projected, you know, across the world. And it's a very unfortunate, and it's understandable, but unfortunate, because in reality, you know, as I was saying before, when you begin to go to what is causing this problem, you actually see that the root causes are a whole set of social and economic development that are tearing people. For example, the issue of land. In many, many cases, behind the killing of a woman or also a man, women are twice as likely as being accused of witchcraft and twice as likely as being murdered. And often in the most atrocious way, macheted or burnt alive, you know. But the issue of land, for example, a classical case across Africa is that a woman remains widowed, and then she inherits the land of the husband, and a relative begin to accuse her of being a witch. So land issues, land disputes, for example, are at the roots of many, many accusations. And often it's just the relatives and so on, or the neighbors, but many times behind them, you know, you may have, in fact, the complicity of companies who are interested in acquiring that land. And for example, there's a number of studies which have shown that witch accusations are more prominent in areas that are destined to be commercialized. You know, for example, to become game parks or ecotourism. And so that in fact, often, who are the real agents, right? That the individuals who are actually doing the macheting or making the accusation, you know, are agents but behind it, there are people who remains invisible, but are important. Or in the case of trade, I think what you're referring to about Ghana, you know, many, many women, and this is not only Ghana, in Nigeria, the competition between the local women who are working at the local market, they are dealing with the local economy, and then these big traders, import exports, right, who are fearing the competition of the women. And so they are accusing, of course, of being witches. And in Ghana, you know, as you know, also very important, there are witches camps, because the number of those who have been killed and die, you know, it's a minuscule part of also those who have been attacked, wounded, survived, or just chased from their villages. Yeah. So now in different parts of Africa, you have so-called witches camps. In Ghana, in the north, you have I think it's three camps. You were there, right?
Well, it was six, and six the government is actively working to close them. They closed one in 2014, uh-huh. and they closed one in 2019. But it's very complex because it's an educational issue, and for now, to closing them entirely can be very unsafe for the people because they've been threatened with murder if they return. So I just want to say that Ghana is a great country. And this is not vilification whatsoever. This mm-hmm. is just trying to provide a platform for the people that are most vulnerable. And yeah, the camps are, which the witchcraft that we've seen across the world exists, like in Saudi Arabia, where, you know, a woman was beheaded in 2011. Yes. But the camps themselves are quite an extraordinary thing. And some of the women, in essence, are coerced or choose to go there preemptively because, as you said, one of the most common forms of murder is to burn down somebody's house in the night, and that often endangers the family. And so they do this in a very self-sacrificial way, often to protect their family, that they leave and leave the land. So there are many scenarios, and it's it's so complex, and ultimately it's just such a sad thing. I'm very curious about you talk a lot about children and the treatment of children. So
it's a very new thing, and which begins really in the 90s. There was not any, but by 1990, you begin to have in a number of places, the Congo, in towns like Kinshasa, in Nigeria, a number of children being charged being witches. And again, it's complicated because, on one side, it's really the breakdown of the family. One of the consequences of the economic dislocation and the mass impoverishment and the tearing of community is the fact that the family too does not hold. And the fact that, for instance, so many of the elderly are accused, the elderly and the children. Okay.
That's right.
In a way, you have families who begin to look at the elderly as a burden, but also the children, it becomes difficult, they're supporting them. So the children witches are unruly, are children who are seen by the family as unmanageable. But here, I think, and I want to reconnect, to the discussion of the role of the media here, because I think there is an important element, two elements that I think need to be brought to the scene. One, the intervention of the Pentecostal sects, which I know is extremely strong in Ghana, but also everywhere. These Pentecostal sects, I often make the comparison with the missionaries. When there was the conquest, when the so-called New World was conquered, you had the conquistadores and you had the missionaries. Today you have the International Monetary Fund, the bankers, who are coming, imposing new restriction, new devaluation, and then you have the Pentecostal sects. And we're coming in with a new brand of religion, that reminds us of Calvinism, very combative, which says, Jesus wants you to be rich. Prosperity is within reach of everybody. If you're poor, it's because somebody is plotting against you. And they are portraying this big conspiracy. Satan is out, to destroy the world. And so here you have population, communities who are already under terrible tension, and it's sowing suspicions. And that process of sowing, it's amplified. I've been reading actually recently exactly the question of the media, the role of the media and the video films in Ghana. Apparently there's been an explosion. The video films industry in Ghana has blossomed on the basis of these horror stories of witches and so on, and often taking in the preaching of the Pentecostal churches, while basically saying witchcraft is real and we have to combat it.
Silvia, we both come from Italy, and I did a little research, and 3,344 women have been killed in the past 20 years in Italy, and 2020 was the worst year for women, because there was the highest percentage of women being murdered, 40.6%, the highest ever. And I just wanted also to open here a little dialogue on also the relationship between female violence and actually racism. You covered this topic very well. You in fact you say in the book that more than 3,000 women die every year in the US, have been dying for the past since the 80s, and but there is little interest from the media. We talked about the media earlier, or from the police. Now I'm a Black Italian woman, and to me, being a Black Italian woman means being the victim not only of sexism, racism, but also of the colonial inheritance of Italy, because there isn't really a critical analysis on the role and the responsibilities of Italy during the colonial era. So what happens is that still today, Italian media speaks with these stereotypes that dehumanize women, Black women in particular. They hypersexualize them. I think about during the colonial era of the cartoonist Enrico De Seta, that, for example, portrayed Abyssinian women completely naked. And I mean, I think that we need to change the narration of mass media towards Black women, but women in general. And so there is a lot of work to do about it.
You're bringing up so many themes that are important and are all interconnected. First of all, the relationship of the witch hunts that are taking place across the world, and the surge of violence against women, and which has many forms, but if they are all interconnected, that has been taking place over the last 3 or 4 decades. For example, there is a big connection between the woman who has been accused of being a witch because her land, she inherited some land, say in Tanzania, and the woman in Brazil or in Paraguay, who is being killed, because she's fighting against land expropriation, or she's fighting because instead, she's fighting against genetic engineering or the coming of a mine to her village who is going to destroy the cropland. There is a connection between the two, the women in Ghana and the Berta Cáceres, in Honduras, who have been killed defending their land. It's a whole a connection, and in both cases, the attack on the commons. In Italy, right, Italy is one of the places where the surge of violence against women. When I was a child, in the 50s, if a woman was killed, I remember some killing of women in the 50s. They were so rare that people talked about it for a long, long time. I still remember some of those cases. Now, as you say, when I visit in the space of a week, almost every day a woman is killed, right? And it's very much connected. And of course, it's all interconnected also with the rise of racism. The Italians, never had to confront an anti-colonial struggle. They confronted it in Libya, in Ethiopia, but they never had to confront it on the Italian soil.
And what's crazy, Silvia, is that it's the only European colony that hasn't done that work, that hasn't done a deep analysis and critics on its responsibility about the thousands of people who have been murdered, women who have been raped, and it's just appalling.
Absolutely. In fact, most people say, no, Italians are not racist. They don't even realize what it means to be racist, and it's something, it's only beginning now, even in the social movement, even in the left and in the feminist movement, is beginning now that process. No, but you don't have anything of what, for example, has taken place in England, where they had to confront. And I'm not trying to set up England as a but at least they had to understand, they had to make some self-analysis. And this has now really begun in Italy. And there is a connection with the, you know, in fact, that's what fascism. Fascism was ferociously misogynous and ferociously racist. Mm-hmm. And the two together, the strong white man, you know, with the chest out, you know, who is the owner of all the resources and looks down with a benevolent or malevolent eye to the subordinates, who are women, who will be accepted if they produce 10 children for the fatherland, and they will be given perhaps a prize, or and also, you know, the colonial subject, men and women. And I think Italy needs, I was very happy to hear that as a response to the big mobilization by Black Lives Matter, for the first time, you know, Italian Africans were out in the street, because in Italy now, even if you're born in Italy, and if you are African, of African descent, you, as you probably know, you cannot become an Italian citizen until you are 19.
Exactly, and that's what we are struggling. We are trying to bring to light. I mean, this problem. We need to change the present citizenship law, exactly. Which is an old law from 1992 that looks at Italy as a country of emigration rather than immigration. So what happens is that there are people, maybe even in the US, who are second, third generations Italian, and they can get the citizenship. They don't speak right. Italian. They don't go to school here. They've never maybe been to Italy. And there are people instead in Italy who are born here, who have studied here, who speak the language, who feels Italian 100% and cannot become citizenship. They can only apply when they are 18. Then they have to wait 3 years. They cannot vote during all that time. And so for us, Black Lives Matter in Italy means to bring that problem to the attention of the government and the mass media, a change of the present citizenship law. It's a major point. Then there are other problems like the rise in violence in Italy towards immigrant people, people who have foreign origin, origins like me. And so, yeah, I mean, it's very connected.
You know,
absolutely.
It's absolutely connected, because it's the question of who has rights, who is a full human being, right? And the fact that women have been fighting in the women's movement to have some autonomy, right? I think has unleashed a whole new level of violence, because there is this you know, very engraved culture of the woman as a subordinate, you know, who is worshipped as a mother as long as she is sacrificial, right? That's the sacrificial right. Mother who only lives for her children, has no desire for anything for herself. So that will be the mother will be, but otherwise, the moment you begin to vindicate, you know, autonomy, your own right as a human being, then you become an object of violence. And this is what has been happening. And I don't want, of course, to generalize to all men or to all, but there is a very strong component in the country who really is there. And I think women and immigrants in particular have to a big struggle ahead.
Absolutely.
Yes, yes. Well, you know, we're gonna open it up to questions soon. It looks like quite a few people have offered questions already, and if more people sure. want through the Q&A, that can be done. One thing that strikes me, and I'm sure you and your insights and your ability to connect all these things globally and the underlying patterns are so such a treasure for the world, really, and for all of us. And one thing that always strikes me is hearing privileged white males, politicians usually, use the term witch hunting anytime somebody criticizes them. And to know that it actually does go on, I think, is important. And, you know, last year, a 90-year-old woman was lynched in Ghana.
Yes.
And again, Ghana is a great country. But there was a witch hunter who had 17 other elderly women lined up for the same thing.
Yes.
And fortunately was stopped. Yes. And as we talked about before, you know, a woman was beheaded in Saudi Arabia in 2011.
Yeah.
But in 2018, women gained the right, you know, the right to drive. So, I mean, there is the ability, the potential for growth through education, and that's what we mm-hmm. that's what we hope for. And thank you for educating me and for hopefully and you know, through your books and through your talks and through your being. So so there's a few questions here. Sure. The first question is from Christy, and it's, have you been able to identify the Western corporations that are involved? I mean, that we're talking about many different places in the world, but are there particular corporations? You were talking about the importers and exporters and the competition with the
I don't know a specific corporation. I'm sure that in some cases it can be found, but what I would like to instead say is that African land right now is under pressure from so many sources. And this is one of the causes of the big conflict then in the communities, because the land is diminishing. So African land, you have, first of all, you have mining. There is extensive mining, particularly in the country like the Congo, but also Sierra Leone, extensive. Second, of course, the oil drilling, Nigeria, but you have the green gasoline. Thousands of hectares of land are being taken over, right, planted with elephant grass for green gasoline. So, and then you have countries who are giving away, actually selling. For example, Ethiopia has been selling thousands and thousands of hectares of land to Saudi Arabia, who doesn't have crop land, and now they are planting crops. So you have the villagers are now being choked. And in fact, what I think that an important point that I really want to develop in my it's that witchcraft, accusation of witchcraft, and are really an expression and a response to the crisis of the commons, to the crisis of African communalism that begins with the communalism of the land. You know, as the land is becoming more and more scarce, what used to be a collective process and a collective, the village is breaking up. And with privatization, land titling, land disputes are multiplying. And the hunger for land is one of the, and of course, you know, men with power connected with police, maybe connected with foreign companies. This is where the motivation to actually dispose of people, like older woman living alone, and she has a big piece of land, you know? And so that, I think, is the one of the main dynamics that is now taking place. There are other dynamics that are connected, but when it comes to land, this is one of the dynamics. So it's not only this company or that company. It's a whole setup that, in fact, is basically making very difficult for people. And remember that Africa is one place, one region, where until the 70s and 80s, the majority was still involved in agriculture. You know, in Asia, for example, the expropriation of people from the land, or Latin America, has proceeded much, much faster, right? And the capitalization of land has been much faster. Africa still had very much communal structure of land cultivation, communal setup, and this is what is now under attack.
Yes. There's a question from Zachary. It's something you talked about earlier, but probably it would be good to deepen even more. I'm currently reading Caliban and the Witch for the first time, and I'm curious if you see any philosophical parallels between old Europe and modern Africa, and how that thinking leads them to witch hunting.
Yeah, I think that, you know, again, the question of, you know, the globalization. I mean, what you have when you pass from a regime, you know, in which people had directly access to land, right? And, you know, they to a regime, for instance, you know, in which they have nothing, right? As Marx says, you know, they only have their own labor to sell. And And in some cases, they cannot even sell it. So you have mass unemployment, right? When you have that, it's not only an economic change, it's a whole structure of values that changes. You know? For example, let me give an example. There is a generational struggle going on in Africa that has to do also with the relation to the monetary economy, right? For instance, in several countries, right, the elderly express the fear that the younger generation will kill them so that they can sell the land, so that they can sell the cows. You know, I've spoken about it in the book, right, in the article that is included in Women, Witch Hunties and Witches. You know, so this is the question of now you have a generation of young men, for instance, unemployed, they don't see a hope for the future, right? But they understand that whatever prosperity they may have comes from a monetary economy. And they have in front of them a kind of gerontocracy, maybe of people are holding on, if they still have a piece of land, they're holding on to their land, or they're holding on to the cows, or they're holding on to the trees, because they have a different conception about what is valuable. The tree is the security for the future. The cow is the security for the future, right? So we have to think of, and that's what I'm, the parallel between the phenomenon in Caliban and the witch and the present, you know, what we call globalization, which is the world expansion of capitalist relation. It's really a change that occurs at so many levels. And for example, I want to add something. It has been pointed out, you know, that one of the things that is fueling, you know, these witch hunts is also the fact that for many people, particularly in the rural area, what are the forces that are shaping their life is becoming more and more difficult to understand. They cannot understand. For example, because the decisions now that are affecting, for example, their agriculture, their agricultural work, their income, etc., are taken in London, they are taken in Chicago. So the price of coffee collapses. All of a sudden, they cannot sell their coffee. All of it, before they used to live, sell growing coffee or cocoa or other agricultural products. Now the agricultural boards have been dismantled because the IMF told the governments to dismantle them, who were giving some guarantee. The prices are collapsing because in Washington, not in Washington, in Chicago, or other markets, that has taken place. And people don't understand, life is becoming, some people are becoming rich and many are becoming poor. And so this is fomenting, right? And of course, the presence of, you know, Pentecostal churches who are saying there is the devil, who are injecting this idea of the devil continuously, right? It's a very explosive, creates a very explosive situation.
Yes, yes. And one of the insights that you have that's so strong and I think is so important is that the misconception is that this is ancient, it's always been in Africa, when in fact, the proof is that it was brought in with colonization. And absolutely, in fact, the camps themselves started in 1920, the oldest ones. And so you mentioned how you see these peaks, 1920, 1960s. Right. And I think that's so important. In many ways, what was brought in, the importation, like in Rwanda, where homosexuality is not illegal because it never was. Yeah. And the countries where it is, it's a fairly recent thing. And a lot of them have now undone those laws. Fortunately for Rwanda, it just always stayed as it was, which was a higher level of tolerance. So we probably just have time for one more question from James. Thank you for all of your work, Silvia. I'm wondering what it is about the image of the witch that makes it such a useful tool for power structures to exploit, providing a focal point for fear and social control.
Oh, that's a very good, because that's what I was going to add, you know, the figure of the witch. The figure of the witch is the figure of the enemy within, close to you, but invisible. It's the perfect image to divide the population, for a divide and conquer, because it tells you that you have to distrust everybody. It tells you that the person is next to you, your neighbor, your even members of your family, you know, secretly. You know, the witch is a person who looks normal, but actually in the night and, you know, conceals a terrible secret. And so it disseminates distrust, creates a culture of suspicion, breaks solidarity. It's the perfect charge for, you know, a politics that wants to destroy communalism. It's really the kind of persecution that is most fit for the destruction of communal relation, you know? And it's the whole idea of the enemy within, you know? And this is why I think it's so damaging, because in this moment, and this is again, I want to make the connection with the Pentecostal sects, you know? Not only they say that witchcraft is real, but you know what they also say is not only is that it is connected to the cult of tradition. It's connected, you know, basically to African culture. Let me put it this way: there is one objective that I think. You know, many who have studied the working of these Pentecostalist sects have observed is that they really try to disconnect people from their communities. You know, they are telling them, look, that tradition is bad. Don't pay attention to the demands that are coming from the community, right? They're trying to break solidarity and create an individualistic culture, right? And so this is the witch, you know? The witch is the person who is near you, may be part of the family, may look normal, but actually is conspiring against you. And may be the cause of your poverty or any misfortune that happens to you.
We certainly in the US have our own problems with treating the elderly and the vulnerable. And you know, I saw that with my mother, the medical system, the way they mistreated her at the end of her life, towards the end of her life. I've seen that with my sister, who has Down syndrome, and due to the trauma and abuse that she suffered during the lockdown, she's now non-ambulatory, and once in a wheelchair, has been mistreated even more, in what I've perceived. And one thing that they've talked about that I think is very interesting is this connection with the children and hunger. Yeah. So I think that was something that is, for me, really resonated.
Yeah, the children is very important. And also, I want to connect with the question of disease, right? Because all this is happening, right? The impoverishment, et cetera, it's happening simultaneously, you know, because of the impoverishment, because of the dismantling of the sanitary system in Africa due to structural adjustment. Practically the sanitary system were totally disinvested. And at the same time begins, you know, all these epidemics, you know, HIV and then Ebola and then, you know, epidemics of meningitis, having to do with malnutrition, with the collapse of immunity system. I've been wondering how many, you know, people are now being accused because of COVID. No, in other words, you know, and the reason that simultaneously you have a rise, increase in diseases and epidemics and a dismantling of the sanitary system. You know, we've seen that in Africa, first of all, right? And, you know, the two come together, you know, has also meant that a lot of people will not have the money to go to a hospital. They will go to a witch doctor. And so you have the return on the scene of many witch doctors who, when they couldn't cure and so on, they would say it's sorcery, it's witchcraft. Mm. That's another piece of the puzzle.
Sure, you know, sure.
What the role of disease and the role, but it's all part of this massive, you know, disruption of the normal ways of life and the impoverishment, which also destroys the bodies of people, destroy their capacity to respond to it.
Yes, and you said that, you know, that often people are accused in the night of being witches, and the reason why children are up in the night is what?
Yeah. Oh, they go to eat.
To eat.
Unruly children. They get up at night and they eat the family food. That is an image so strong, right? They are unruly because they get up in the night. These to me are hungry children.
Yes.
These are hungry children, right? And then often they are thrown into the street. The statistics are that in Kinshasa, there are more than 20,000 children in the street. One speaks of 15,000 in Nigeria, many abandoned children. The family doesn't want them because they are afraid that they will bring misfortune, or maybe because they cannot support them, right? And or they are subjected to this ritual of exorcism, right? Which means there are these tortures, they are forced to drink things, etc. They are beaten for deliverance.
Yes.
So that the spirits, the devil goes out of their bodies.
Yes.
So you're now in Africa, you have these two new figures, the exorcist and the witch finder. Because in some cases, the accusation begins with the chief bringing in a witch finder, you know. And but again, what makes it possible? And that's why I think we should go beyond the fear that this is reinforcing the racist paradigms, you know, because really the structural problems really come from international politics.
Yeah.
That, you know, if you're going to put a population under a certain strain, this will happen all over the world. And this is happening. This is happening all over the world.
Yes. Well, I think we're almost out of time. Marlena, did you have any last thoughts? She studied up a lot on your book.
I don't know. I was thinking about what you said. We were talking about Africa and the fact that we are in the middle of a pandemic and Africa is completely cut out. Is not able to have vaccines. So it's going to be the last place on Earth probably where the vaccine is going to be distributed. And this is so shameful and intolerable. Also, final thought. And I love Silvia how you say that you know, women needs to be a unity, and only if they will actively be united and fight against these forces, they will be able to stop this phenomenon. And you provide many examples, like women who campaign to raise awareness about the problem of witch hunting, so women creating refugees for women who are persecuted. Only together. We have to get back together, just like in the old days, before before our unity was completely dismantled by the capital system. And you also say how capitalism was, the birth of capitalism coincides with the birth of witch hunting. It's not a coincidence. And now it's time to be together and be united. And so Thank you so much, Silvia, for being here tonight.
Thank you, Marilene. Thank you, Jan.
Grazie.
This is a conversation that will carry on. And I want to connect particularly because you are in Italy, because that's an issue that is very, very important for me.
Yes.
Very, very important. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, and actually there are some people also from Italy, I think, following us tonight. And they were thrilled about tonight's event. Yes. So you are very loved, I think, everywhere in the world, Silvia.
Thank you very much for saying that. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Silvia. And please, everybody, buy her book, one of them, all of them. They are great books because they have such great information, but also so well written. And there's a chapter on Witch Camp in my last book, and the record will be coming out March 14th. Isa and Politics and Prose and Alan, thank you so much for existing, and thanks for having us here tonight.
Yes, thank you, Isa, and thank you all for listening tonight. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. And we like to wrap up by asking, though, one last question from us is, what are you guys reading? What are you currently reading? What's exciting you? Yeah, so feel free to share with the class.
So what I'm reading now is, for instance, what I'm reading right now, it's a book that I'm also reviewing and writing an introduction by Veronica Gago. It's called, in Spanish, Potencia Feminista, in English, Feminist International. And it's a book which is inspired by the big, big mobilization, feminist mobilization that has been taking place in Argentina over the last 5-10 years, you know, which has led to the victory recently. They finally obtained the right to abortion, which was a major, major struggle because they had not only the government against it, but the Vatican. By the way, I want to add, the Vatican has been running for some years now seminars on exorcism. They are actually teaching priests how to exorcise. So the Vatican has also introduced in their discourse the concept of the devil. This is a very important element to add to the discussion we had before. So Potencia Feminista is basically a book that looks at what the feminist movement means today. The fact that there is a transnational feminism that is surging as expressed through the International Women's Strike. And I think the book connects all the themes that we've been talking about land, about debt, about money, about impoverishment, but also about organizing to change this world. And the slogan is, we are moved by the desire to change everything.
Well, great. And wow. I just finished reading The Lady of Nile. And it's a novel by a Rwandan author. I have to go into my library to get the exact name of the author. I'm just starting exploring Rwandan literature. Rwanda is my mother's country. And so it's such a beautiful book that unfortunately hasn't been translated into Italian. So I was even considering maybe finding a way to have it translated into Italian. So that's the book I'm reading.
What's the title again?
The Lady of Nile.
The Lady of Nile.
Our Lady of Nile. Uh-huh. And it's beautiful because it's, you know, it's Rwanda in the 70s. So right on the verge of the second genocide of 1973. And this author is my mother's same age. And so it's just amazing. And I learned so many more things about Rwanda that I haven't learned from my mom, who has always been kind of silent a little bit about it because of the pain, you know, that she always has due to what she lived. You know, she lost all everyone, everything. Mm-hmm. So that's why I wanted, you know, to explore more this Rwandan literature, and I'm doing it right now. That's all.
I'm reading a few different books at the same time, but honestly, what I was rereading this week was witches, witch hunting, and women. So, and this is probably the fourth time I've reread it. So
in Italian too, same book.
So buy it and read it. It's
great.
It's a treasure.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Silvia, Marilena, and Ian, for sharing your time and your insight. It was wonderful having you. And thank you, audience. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. Your patronage is what enables us to bring programming like this, and we cannot continue to host events like these without the book sales to support them. So please support our very wonderful guests in Politics and Prose by using the links in the chat to purchase their books, Silence by Sound, Witches, Witch Hunting and Women, Caliban and the Witch, and Beyond the Periphery of the Skin. I'm sure these are all going to be fantastic reads. Check our website for the most current updated event listings, as we have a great list of other speakers to choose from. And we do hope to see the audience there. And thank you again for joining us this evening. Thank you. Cannot thank you enough, Silvia, Marlena, and Ian, for your time. I'm freaking out. I'm still freaking out. So thank you. Stay strong, stay safe, and
thank you.
Well, everyone. We will see you all next
time. You too. Yes. And we'll be in touch.